It's Wednesday night, and we are studying a number of subjects because they're all running into each other. If you actually study the Bible in detail, and you start with the front of the Bible with Genesis, it's going to take you through Adam and Cain killing Abel. It's going to take you up through the flood with Noah and all of his family there in Genesis 5. And that's going to take you on up to the 11th chapter of Genesis. And Genesis 11 is where Babel is built at the first of the chapter, or the beginning of the Babylonian Empire. And at the end of the chapter is the birth of Abraham, or Abram, as always called at first. Then you go on through here, and you see God calling Abraham to... Everything is in sequence. It's the way... It's chronological actions. And then it takes you to Abraham, and then the promise to Abraham that you'll have a son in chapter 15, and tell him exactly who his son will be over there in chapter 17. You got in chapter 16, you got Abraham going into the handmaiden, Hagar, handmaiden of Sarah. And then it takes you on down to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And all of this is chronologically happening in time in this exact order. It'll take you all the way down through Genesis. And then you'll get down here to the end of Genesis is where Joseph is sold into bondage over there in Egypt. And then after he's been there some years, and after 7 and 7, 7 good years, 7 bad years, and that's the dream that he translated over to, or he interpreted the dream over to the Pharaoh. And then you got 400. You know why I put this on the board so much? Because that's the sequence of events. I try to get down all the dates on them. When you get down to the end of Genesis, this is one book. That's one book. And you've got from Genesis all the way to the Gospels. You've got about, there's a little jiggle here in time, because Joseph is, you have a 400-year period where they're in bondage, and they come out of bondage in Exodus. In fact, Moses is told to lead the children out of Exodus, the 3rd chapter. So you've got about 2,100 years, a little more or less, could be 2,200, in the book of Genesis. And the rest of the Old Testament, the rest of the 4,000 years, about 1,700 years, is from Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st, 2nd, Samuel, 1st, 2nd Kings, 1st, Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. It takes you on down to Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, then Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. All the rest of those books are right there. This is the longest period of the Old Testament. Now, where was I going? The best thing you can do is learn this timeline. I'm going to keep putting this on the board, because when you get down here, and the best way to remember this is when you get down here, remember, Exodus is when they leave Egypt. Leviticus is the Levitical law. Numbers is, that's what we've been talking about on Wednesday night. That's Israel leaving Egypt. And the majority of the time in Egypt is found in the book of Numbers. That's from the time they leave Mount Sinai for 40 years later. When they leave Mount Sinai and Moses has the law, and he gets that in Exodus and Leviticus, then the 40 years of God causing them to wander through the wilderness has to do with the book of Numbers. The book of Deuteronomy is just the last year, somewhere within the last year, Moses writes this book, and that's just before they cross the land, and Israel is being warned one more time. Remember, Deuteronomy, duo, comes from duo and nomos. Duo, the EUO, means second law. Second law, what it's saying, it takes two witnesses to put a man to death in Israel. Deuteronomy is second to the rest of the law back here. It's God saying it a second time. And then you get into going into Israel, coming over into the promised land, and then being ruled by judges and by kings, and then being scattered all over the earth. And that's basically the rest of the Bible, except you got to fill in all the details. Now, we've been talking about the picture of Numbers is the picture of us going through trials and fires in this life, just having all kinds of hard times. This wilderness here is a shadow for our lives over here. It's a shadow. And everything they had was the plan and the program of God. What God planned for them was trials, tribulation. David said, I only learned to obey you, Lord, when you put me through tribulation. I like the book I've got over here by Thomas Watson, All Things for Good. He says everything is for good. All the evil is for good. If we ever learn to understand that, if we're believers, any believer, every believer, everything you have ever suffered, the things you don't like in your life is the will of God. That's the way it is. And if you'll keep in it long enough, you'll get to where you don't stress out like you used to. I don't ever stress. Me and Mary she has some health problems. And we told the doctor today, we said, we don't stress over nothing. I don't even stress when somebody gives me a hard time and gossips about me and lies about me. I just learn to leave it alone, because that's going to happen, isn't it? Well, let me just read a verse here. People, if you're really coming to a point where you're trying to live for the Lord, you're still going to be getting angry once in a while, but the Lord commands us not to be angry at what men do to us. Jesus said, I'll not fear what men shall do unto me. Paul said, I'll not fear what men will do unto me. The Lord is my helper. I want us to learn, if we can ever learn, everything that's going on in our life, just like that wilderness, it is a trial, it is a tribulation, and it is for one thing. It is to mature us and get us to where we're not even concerned about those things. The things that used to worry me, I don't even think about them. When somebody does something wrong, I say, well, that's wrong. Let's just keep going. Let them do what they're doing, because God has got it arranged for them to do what they're doing, no matter how evil it is. And if they're not believers, He's ordained them to do it in your life to help straighten your life out. Now, what they're going through, I'm going to say something, talk about something I talked about last week. Not just to repeat something, but to help people see this more. What we're going through is the same thing they went through over there. It was called a baptism. It's called a baptism. Look back over here at 1 Corinthians. Look over here. First Corinthians. We've been talking about the church in the wilderness. The Bible says Stephen stood before the Sanhedrin and he said, This prophet whom ye shall hear, he was with the church in the wilderness, there in the 7th chapter of Acts. Speaking of Jesus, Jesus with the church, not just with Israel, with the church in the wilderness. And look over in 1 Corinthians 10. Moreover, brethren, verse 1, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea into the wilderness, and were all baptized into Moses in the cloud in the sea. But they didn't get wet going over the sea, did they? Their baptism was not a literal baptism. And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud. They were baptized in the cloud. They were covered. What this is talking about is being covered with God's protection. And did all eat the same spiritual meat. So he's not talking about literal here, literal baptism. He's talking about a spiritual baptism. And did all drink the same spiritual drink? Eat my flesh and drink my blood, you'll have eternal life. That's what we have to do. But eat flesh and drink blood means to eat and drink of truth. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. He was also that man that was in the wilderness, him shall ye hear there in Deuteronomy 18. But with many of them God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. That's speaking of their murmuring against God in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples, tupas. That's our word, type. They were our types. They were our shadows, and they were not the real thing. We're talking about when they went through the wilderness in the book of Numbers, and we're going to continue in that as we go here. Now, these things were our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things. The reason they were there was to teach us not to lust. If you'll lust after things when you're young, you'll work real hard to get it. You'll always draw back a nub, and you won't get what you went out for. And all it does to the believer is hurt them until you get older and you say, why am I doing this? This is not any fun. Everybody that's trying to get rich and get to the top of the world, every one of them are struggling. I don't care what Bill Gates says. I know his is a struggle. I read J. Paul Getty's biography, Richest Man in the World in the 60s. He said that Mr. Rockefeller, when he was at the top and the richest man in the world in the 20s, that he couldn't eat anything. His stomach was perforated with ulcers, and all he thought about was getting a contract in the Gulf and beating one of the other billionaires out of all their money and getting the contracts and making money and accomplishing something. He just wanted to win. And you never do win, you die when you're doing that. Neither be ye idolaters, as some of them were. It is written, the people sat down to drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, and some of them committed and fell in one day 320,000. He is saying, don't go out here and commit fornication with men and women. But he's saying, don't go after gods, because the word God, the word idolatry, porneia, fornication, means idolatry. Idolatry means to serve what you see, whether it's a woman, a man, a car, a money, or a house, or what. If you serve the stuff of this world, you're going to be greatly disappointed. I said this to somebody. Most people my age don't talk about how they are and how their life is short. I know, and if I say this, I don't mean this for anybody to feel sorry for me, and I'm not being negative. I don't have that much longer to live. If you are 77 or 80. You don't have much longer to live. You just don't. Fool yourself if you want to. I'm not fooling myself. I don't want to live that much longer. Except for the church and my family, I would soon to go out of here tonight. My body's tired. I'm tired of the world. But I'm not sad and tired. I'm just wore out. Now, but in that being wore out, you know what I've learned to do? Accept whatever people said to me. I want to go back to this word baptism, because we haven't really exhausted that. That is a ritual. This is what's wrong with the world. We said this last week in Colossians 2:8. In 2:8, beware lest any man spoil you. Spoil is the word sulagogeo. S-U-L-A-G-O-G-E-O. Sulagogeo means to lead back into darkness. Now that's what the children of Israel came to when they said, we want to go back to Egypt. They got out there and they murmured against God, and God would kill them by the thousands as they would murmur against him. There were probably 3-4 million people out there in the desert, and they had no food. They had no sustenance of any kind, no water. Moses said, follow me. And they walked into a desert where there was nothing to take care of them, nothing. I read something here a couple of weeks ago. I may read it from time to time so people will understand. When you follow God, Paul said, be ye followers of me even as I am of Christ. Now, you really wouldn't want to follow Paul, because he was running all over the civilized world preaching. They were running him out of town. They'd run him out of Antioch. They're calling him names down here in Cyprus. They ran him out of Antioch. He ran over to Iconium and then Lystra and then Derbe. They tried to kill him at Lystra. And when he says, be ye followers of me, he's saying, act like I act. And the word follower is the word memetes. Now, that means to mimic. Well, if Paul says mimic me, and people say, I don't know how to witness, I say, follow me around. But you're probably not going to like the response I get when somebody gives me a hard time. If they'll give you that harder time, most people want to keep quiet. You have to keep quiet until you get strong enough to speak up. And you won't do that until you study enough of this book. I speak up a lot. I don't ever chew anybody out. I don't jump their case. I'll just say, well, I don't celebrate Christmas. I love the Lord with all my heart and soul, but I found out that Christmas is paganism. It has nothing to do with Jesus. Did you know that? I'll say it to them real gentle, real kind, real quiet. And I don't always say something, because sometimes they just turn their nose up like, I don't want to hear anything you say. I say, that's okay. All right. Now, what they were going through over here was a baptism. They were going through a blood baptism. And a blood baptism is daily dying. And it is also a spirit baptism. And it is also anywhere you have death to self, it is a daily cross. These are all the same thing. Daily cross. And it is a baptism of fire. Fire was identified with tribulation. When the Bible says over there in 1 Peter 4:12, to think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you. That word try is the word perasmos. Perasmos means to go through severe persecution and trial. So tribulation is fire, and that's a baptism. And, of course, we're going through a blood baptism, and a blood baptism was a term in the first century they used to speak of a death or some severe ordeal. When Jesus looked at James and John over here in Mark, the 10th chapter, Mark 10, Mark 10. Well, no, not Mark 10. Oh, I'm in Luke 10. That's why I couldn't find it. What am I thinking of? All right. Now, Mark, in Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, these are the Gospels. These are the life story of Jesus' life from four different men's viewpoint, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all tell the Gospels. They never contradict. And they one will say something one way, another will say something. And you may have Matthew. You got Matthew, Mark, and Luke speaking of about the man of the Gadarenes. Matthew talks about the man of the Gadarenes in Matthew, the 8th chapter. Luke talks about the man of the Gadarenes. Mark talks about the man of the Gadarenes in Mark, the 5th chapter. And Luke talks about the man of the Gadarenes in Luke, the 8th chapter. If you're going to talk about demons, which we don't believe in, think 8, 5, and 8, demon. That way you can remember where each one of those are. And this is the one everybody else wants to talk about, what went down into the pigs, self, the desire for self. Well, Jesus wouldn't break the laws of nature. Would he walk on water? Would he tell the storm to hush? Shh. That's breaking the laws of nature. All right. Now, where was I going to? Okay, Mark 10. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee. Now, you have to understand, there's not as many chapters in Mark as you've got in Matthew. You got 28 chapters in Matthew, and you got 16 chapters in Mark. So when you find the death of Christ in the book of Mark, it's going to be somewhere at the end of the book of Mark that's not as far away from the front of Matthew. You got to learn to measure those. Then he says here in Mark 10. Now, since we've only got 16 chapters in Mark, this is right before Jesus is taken to die the next day. Well, Jesus, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, there in Galilee, they were fishermen. The sons of Zebedee came unto Jesus, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we desire. A little bit on the selfish side, isn't it? I think so. And Jesus said unto them, What would you that I do for you? And they said unto him, Grant unto us that we may sit one on the right hand and the other on the left hand in thy glory. Sounds like us, doesn't it? But Jesus said unto them, You don't know what you're asking. Some people say, I want what Jim, one fellow told, somebody told me one fellow stood at the back of the church one time and said, I want to be where he is, and pointed at me. Of course, he doesn't even go to church anywhere now. He came here pretending to really believe God, went up north, started him a ministry, came back down here, and he was seen on the street by Steve one day, and he said, "I don't believe that stuff anymore. I don't believe that predestination. I don't believe anything anymore." And he wanted to be, what he wanted was the glory. Let me tell you, this is not glory. You don't know what you ask. Can you drink the cup that I drink of and be baptized with a baptism that I am baptized with? Now, this is after John the Baptist has dipped him in water, isn't it? It's after that. And they said unto him, "We can." And Jesus said unto them, "Ye shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of, and with the baptism I am baptized withal, shall ye be baptized." You're going to die the death. Now, here's something that's amazing. When you study, people miss verses because they're not thinking. When you study scholars, they'll say, "Well, we know what happened to James. He was beheaded there in the book of Acts. But we don't really believe that John the Beloved, after he was boiled in oil and put on Patmos, we don't believe he suffered martyrdom." What did Jesus say right here? You will die the death. You will be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with. He's not talking about water. And when you go to Luke, the 12th chapter, Luke the 12th chapter, Luke 12, verse 49. "I am come to send fire on earth, and what will I if it already be kindled?" I've come to kindle a fiery baptism. "But I have a baptism to be baptized with. How am I straitened, Seneca?" Held. The word echo is a Greek word that means to hold. When we have an echo, we hold a sound. Hello, 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 hello. This just means to hold. It means to hold together. How am I held together? Until it be accomplished. It's not accomplished yet. I've already been dipped in water, but there's one baptism. He says, "How am I held together till it be accomplished? Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth? I tell you, nay, but rather division. I have come to divide families. I've come to divide your family. And if you're a believer and nobody hates you, nobody dislikes you, there's something wrong with your life. You have to be hated. Jesus said, if the world hated me, it's going to hate you, and you're going to have to go through the blood baptism through the fire. And then he says, the Father. He said, from henceforth there shall be five in one house, divided against three, against two, and two against three. The Father shall be divided against the Son against the Father, the Mother against the daughter, and the daughter against the mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Does that sound like us? Sound like us, doesn't it? And he said unto the people, when you shall see a cloud arise out of the west, straightway you shall know there cometh a shower. When you see the south wind blow, you say, there'll be heat. And it cometh to pass, you hypocrites. He says these same words in Matthew, the 16th chapter, verse 1. Verse 3, about, I believe it. And when you see the south wind blow, you say, it will be heat, and it cometh to pass, you hypocrites, you actors, hypocrites, H-U-P-O-K-R-I-T-E-S. It means an actor. That was a stage actor under an assumed character. You've assumed being the character that you're acting like. You're acting like a Christian and you're not. Under assumed character. And those people in the first century, they were, and they pretended, these Pharisees would pretend to be something they were not, and they were acting, you hypocrites. You can discern the face of the sky and the earth, but how is it that you do not discern the times, signs of the times? Yea, and why even of yourselves judge ye not what is right? You're not judging what's right. If you did, you'd judge yourself guilty. Now, look over here. Look here in... I'm going to take you to some place. Now, all during Jesus' life, let me say this. And this... I'm trying to help people understand. Baptism is not water. But let me say it like this. Baptism is not water any longer. No longer is it water. We do not believe in a water baptism. Before Jesus died, there were many baptisms. When you look at the word baptism, it's a very puzzling word. It doesn't mean what we think it means. Before he came, there were many baptisms. After his death, after he was nailed to the cross, there was no longer many, there was one baptism. Let me explain this to you slow so you can understand. There was only one. Look at Ephesians, and then I'll go to Hebrews 9. Ephesians 4. And verse 5. You're not going to understand this unless you understand approximately when the book of Ephesians was written. You're not going to be able to relate it with the many baptisms over here. The book of Ephesians was written somewhere in the neighborhood of 57 A.D., and it was written after he made his first trip, not his first journey, but his first trip to Ephesus. On his first journey, he didn't go to Ephesus. On his first journey, he just went up here to Cyprus, up here to Perga, up here to Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, and back home. That was his first journey, pretty short. On his second journey, he came up, left Antioch here, headed up towards the Antioch over here, just like we got a lot of Columbuses, Columbus, Ohio, Columbus, Georgia, Columbus. They're all over the country. So he comes up here, comes down to Cyprus, comes up here and goes, it's forbidden to go up here, God's not ready for him to go there, and he goes through Ephesus on his second journey. And that's where they try to kill him. They run him into the Colosseum and they're going to kill him because they say he's preaching against the idols of Diana. And that was a center for worship of Diana. Her temple there, as you come into one of those bays, and you can see her miles off, a great big, huge, gigantic statue of her. Now, look, where did I say we were? Ephesians. You have to understand when the book of Ephesians was written in order to understand what I'm about to tell you. I've said it real fast going through it, but let me take my time. Verse 4. There's one body. The body's the bread. The bread is the flesh. The bread is the church. This one body. When Jesus said, take, eat, this is my body, he was performing a contract. there's one spirit. There's not two different spirits, not a Holy Spirit for jumping up and down and making a fool of yourself in a Pentecostal charismatic church. Even as you're called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith. Now there's one baptism, Paul says, to an Ephesian Gentile church. Ephesian. And he has a reason for saying that to the Ephesian church, because the church at Ephesus was a Gentile proselyte church. Proselyte because all Gentiles, when they came into Israel to become a citizen of Israel, here's what they were called. They had several titles for them. They would call them strangers. That means a person who is from another land that has heard about Israel, heard about their God, and they want to become a Jew. But they're going to have to be Gentile Jews. Now, when you get into Ephesians, Paul will say there's neither Jew nor Greek. But you got to remember what the time factor is that he's saying that. Jew nor Greek, there's neither bond nor free, there's neither male nor female, for we are all one in Christ Jesus. So, among the Ephesians, before Jesus died, Jesus dies here, this is the day of his death. When he died, there's two parts to the law. Two parts. The two parts to the law is the letter. That is the ritual. And the spirit. It is everything spiritual as opposed to the ritual. The Jews did not want to keep the rituals. They didn't want to keep anything, but they wanted to make up their own laws. We'll get back into that. There was the spirit and the letter. Let me show you that one more time over here, and I'll come back to Ephesians. Look over here in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians. This is something for people has a hard time understanding. All right. Second, the Jews were a real small nation. They were a thorn in the Roman Empire. They were a thorn in their flesh. As small as they were always having insurrections. An insurrection is rebellion against their rulers. They would get people together from time to time. They had a man named Jesus Bar Kokhba. He tried to lead a revolution against Rome. Of course, he died. And they were always having rebellions. In Luke, the 17th chapter, Jesus said, suppose ye that you were these people in Galilee that Pilate crucified on their own altar or killed on their own altars. You suppose that they were more wicked than you are? That's when he said, except you repent, you'll all likewise perish, just like they did. The Roman Empire was always at war with Israel. That's why they had Roman legions. Legions were 300, up to 300 men all over Jerusalem, because they acted up constantly, and they always taking the Jews before the Caesar, just or before Pilate or one of the governors, just like they did Jesus. That was a real common thing for them to do. So they were a thorn to the Roman Empire. And yet they survived, and the Roman Empire is nothing now. Now, I was going to give you something there. All right. So what they were doing, everybody that wanted to come to Israel, if you had a man over here, wanted to become a part of the kingdom of God, it was because he started believing in Jehovah God. And he was called a proselyte or a stranger. Now, the proselyte process, it varied through the years. But it was very firm during certain periods. They would change and add things that they didn't have. And they had to do three things. If you were a Gentile, and you were a Gentile, it's everybody that's not a Jew, and you were going to come down to Israel, first of all, the Pharisees wanted to win them over as proselytes for their money, but they considered these converted Jews, converted Gentiles, the most low life in the world. They couldn't even get any respect coming into Israel. They had to come in to Israel, and they had to be circumcised first of all. And then they had to be washed in water. Now you got to remember, after Jesus dies, the rituals are nailed to the cross. The circumcision is nailed. The water washing is nailed. The two turtle doves is nailed. And that was a part of the law. But all the way to 70 AD, all of the Pharisees were trying to bring as many people into Israel as they could. They wanted their money. They wanted their backing. So they were trying to bring them in. 70 AD is when the son of Caesar, Titus, came in. And he overthrew Jerusalem, took some time to do that. He overthrew him, and all the Phariseeism kind of went the way of everything else. But the circumcision, the washing in water, they kept doing that after Jesus' death, even though the Bible says in Colossians 2:14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. You got two handwritings. Let me just open up to those, because there's some things I'm trying to get over to people about baptism. The key is, when the Lord said there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, God has reduced all baptisms in Hebrews, the 9th chapter. All proselyte baptism, when he was nailed to the cross, was nailed with it. And when you drove a nail through a contract publicly with two witnesses present, it invalidated that contract. Where all the water washing went to, and sometimes the Pharisees would use the word baptizo or baptismos to express their water baptism. When baptism actually comes from two words, baptizo and babto. Baptizo means to cover. Babto means to stain and to dye. You'll get this out of McClintock and Strong, and you can get it out of this book here. Right here. Mr. Girdlestone, great Greek scholar. I need to make copies of all these and give them to people. Mr. Girdlestone, numerically coded to Strong's Exhaustive Concordance, and he tells you in here, this is Girdlestone's Synonyms of the Old Testament, talking about synonyms, talking about the Septuagint, Old Testament, the Greek. Let me read you what he said, a great scholar of the Greek. Now he says, all right, now it puzzles a lot of them. The point I want to get over to you It's not how many baptisms there was before Christ. I want to get it down to how many baptisms were there after Christ. You can study all these proselyte baptisms. Some of them say it, some of the scholars will say it was an infinitive, a verbal noun, and that's the way the scholars that describe it in the Bible. When Peter commanded them to be baptized, that's an infinitive. An infinitive is a noun in the English language and in the Greek language. It's a noun with verbal character. To be baptized means to be covered, not to cover. It means to be covered with a stain or dye. It means the barn, after you cover it, it is to be covered, but it becomes covered later. And it means to stain and to dye. It doesn't mean what people are saying. It had various different meanings back here, but up here there's only one baptism up here. But what is it now? Let me read something here to you, and then I'm going to read something out of the Bible and explain it to you as well. People, you know what they're looking for? They're looking for a Bible that they don't have to think. Do you think that the Bible was written in our language? No. When you go back to the Greek language, they got participles, they got infinitives, they've got subjects and predicates and direct objects, and you got all these descriptive words, you got adverbs and adjectives. You can't just come and say, I think that means. You can't do that. And he says here, as to the exact bearing of the symbol of baptism, talking about the washing, and as to the nature of the nexus, N-E-X-U-S, which means link or connection that exists between the sign and the thing signified. The sign and the thing signified is, what does that mean, washing a man be dipped in water? What does that mean? Whatever it meant, it was nailed to the cross with Jesus. When our Lord gave orders to his followers to baptize, how would the word that he used be understood? Now that really bothers me, because John the Baptist is saying in Matthew the 3rd chapter, I baptize with water. What he was doing was a proselyte baptism of being washed in water that they called a new birth. And you had to be circumcised first. If you had to be circumcised, you got to be washed. And then they had to offer an offering, which was two doves. And I wish I could get, here's a section out of McLennan and Strong, just on proselyte. Here's a section out of McLennan and Strong, just on baptism, and it's very thick, about 50 pages. And then here's another out of Hastings that's on proselytes. I have never, ever heard a preacher deal with proselyte, the word proselyte or proselytes, and I have heard more preachers than anybody I know of. Never heard one of them talk about it. And yet Jesus would tell the Pharisees, you scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, woe unto you. You compass sea and land to make one proselyte so you can dip him in water, circumcise him, dip him in water, and he's a Gentile, and then you're going to look at him like a piece of filth and make him offer this offering, and then you can suck the life out of him. Say, we need your tithe. And they had various types of proselytes. They had a proselyte of the gate. I'll talk to you about that later. And a proselyte of righteousness. The proselyte of righteousness could take part in all the things that the Jews took part in. But they had to go through this three-part process. I've got so many things. I've got books on church historians, Williston Walker, Enoch Pond, Backhouse and Tyler. None of them say you should be dipped in water, eat crackers, and drink grape juice. Then I've got the Apostolic Fathers, which goes back to the first and second century, and they'll say things like, the word of truth is our Eucharist. It's like, what? They'll say things that doesn't sound anything like the guys are saying today. You know why we're so off base? We've been getting apostate for 2,000 years. That's why we're so far off. The churches are way out in left field. And I've got so many books in my library, and I got books that are complicated and complex and detailed. I have to sit there and read some of it over and over to get a hold of what it's saying. Then after a while, I'm going, oh, that's what he's saying. It's the Bible is too boring to the average man to read it and want to understand it. The Bible is very complicated when you go into it's detailed when you go into all the Greek language and the parts of speech. I'm trying to give you some things that are fairly simple. Because if you really want to understand this, then you need to go to school for about 10 years and study Greek and Hebrew and history and all the rest of it. I've spent 60 years studying it, and I've just learned enough to know I don't know a whole lot. People say, boy, you sure do know a lot. You sure are smart. I say, not according to my viewpoint. You'll never learn a lot about the Bible. We'll know enough to live with. And I want to feed people as much as I can to help them to grow. Now listen to what Mr. Girdlestone says. When our Lord gave orders to his followers to baptize, how would the word that he used be understood? This is really boggles my mind. I teach just on that right there. Now this is simple enough for a fourth grader to understand when I say this. When John the Baptist says, I baptize with water, there's one coming after me, he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. The first time I saw that, I was young. I just looked at it with the most puzzled look on my face. If you could have had a question mark above my head, there would have been one there. What? Holy Ghost and fire? It wasn't until I was down here at Rivergate one day, and I was in a bookstore, and they had some books real cheap out front. Well, the books real cheap are the ones that I usually want, because that's the ones that's real complicated or detailed that nobody wants this. And I got a book, picked it up, and it said these words, Harvest of Hellenism. Now, I knew what Hellenism was. But I doubt seriously if the person that bought that book knew had any idea what that was about. Hellenism, Hellas, is a term for Greece. Hellenism is the culturalization of the world by the Greek people, particularly Alexander the Great. Alex Great. Now, Alexander the Great lived from around 330 to 333 B.C. to approximately somewhere in the neighborhood of 319 B.C., where he died in Babylon. And he gave all of the world its culture, customs. Anytime you see a book, And it says Hellenism, and particularly if it says in the title of the book, if it says Hellas, H-E-L-L-E-S, it's the title for Greece, and particularly if it says Stoicism. Stoicism or Epicurean. If it says either or both of those words, especially if it has both of them, grab it. If you're at a garage sale. Because the world was living from 300 B.C. until the death of Christ. They were living before this and after this in a Greek state of mind. Because the world had been conquered by Alexander, and all of the culture and the education and the sayings and the philosophies, they were in the world. And when Paul is writing to these people out here, Paul is a missionary to the Gentiles or to the Greeks. They wouldn't say Romans, even though Rome was ruling. Paul would say there's neither Jew nor Greek, because Greek encompassed the entire world, not just the nation of Greece, because they all had all these Greek languages, Greek sayings, Greek glossa, Greek dialects, and they were, everybody in the world was educated in the culture of Greece. And they had a And all of that, when Jesus died, he said, now there's no Greeks, no Jews, nobody. We're all one in Christ. That's why he would say that. And besides that, I blotted out all the Epicurean sayings, all the Stoic sayings, and I couldn't get over that when I found that Harvest of Hell. I got to a place in there. I got to a chapter, and it said, a man named Zeno. Now, if you're going to study the way of life of the people of the Bible, when Paul wrote his letters to Rome, wrote his letters to Philippi, Thessalonica, these are all Gentile churches. He was writing to the converts would be, as far as before Christ, they would be proselytes. All converts would be proselytes. But they don't call them that anymore. Peter referred to them as strangers. He said, I'm writing to the strangers throughout the world. And that was proselytes. Their culture, their sayings. When John the Baptist made this statement, I'm saying it slow because I've never slowed down on this. According to the Harvest of Hellenism, when he made this statement, I baptize with holy Ghost and fire. I've never saw it in another book. This guy was a brilliant scholar. Holy is the word hagios. Pure. Pneuma is the word ghost. Same word as spirit means breath. Holy, pneuma, and pur. Spirit and fire. That was the saying back then. Holy pneuma and pur. I'll get it right in a minute. Holy Ghost and fire. Holy pneuma and pur. Pur is the word fire. And Mr. Zeno, he came up with some screwy idea. But since they had adopted these sayings just like we have them, we got all kinds of idioms and metaphors in our language. Since they had all these metaphors, Jesus would use them. Paul would use them. Half of the New Testament is about their idioms and their metaphors and about Stoics and about Epicureans. Epicureans. A whole lot of the things. What you've got to get, you've got to get another book. And it's called, light in the ancient East. Light from the ancient East. Light from the ancient East. And when you begin to read that, he will tell you his name is Lightfoot. I got different Lightfoots that were riders. His name is Lightfoot, and he will tell you all about culture, customs, sayings, idioms of the Greek world when Paul was writing to all of these churches at Galatia, at Ephesus, at Colossae, at Thessalonica. You won't find this in regular everyday books. But he goes into it, and I'll get this nailing Christ to the cross. Well, it was very interesting. I'll come back and read some more out of that. We've got to have more than the Bible. People say, one guy come in here one time said, you have too much extra biblical information. I'll say it like I said that day. You are ignorant. If you can learn everything you can about the world, the ancient world, you can understand more of the Bible. Nobody knows anything about it. I know a little. I never heard a preacher, a famous preacher, say anything about it. Holy Ghost and fire was such a common word that everybody had known about that for 300 years. Holy Ghost and fire. Mr. Zeno said all of our universe, our stars, our sun, the stars out there, everything in our universe, he called it a living being like me, like this. It was a living being, and he said something gave it life, and he said what gave it life was pneuma, spirit, and fire. So whenever you take and you find life, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the spirit and the fire. It was such a common word to them. If you said spirit and fire, well, what that is, that's life. That's being baptized with life. And when you're baptized with life, resurrection means to come to life after dying. And we have to die daily, and that's a daily cross, and that's a blood baptism. So notice how all these things come together and they fit together. So whenever you've got a Holy Ghost and fire baptism, that's a baptism of life. And a blood baptism was a death. And when you die daily and you come to life. And that's a resurrection. That's anastasis, the word resurrection. And that's feminine gender. And that's the church coming back to life after dying daily. And that's the spirit baptism. Holy Spirit is the same thing as this pneuma and per or life. It's a fire. And that's a daily cross. As we're going through this wilderness, people are attacking us when we're out here. They give us a hard time. And that's being baptized. Let me finish this. This is I'm still in this book by Girdlestone about baptism. The English translator did not translate the word baptize. He says the Catholics and the Protestants, when they got to the word baptized in the 1611 translation of the Bible, when they started about 1605, they got the word baptized and they didn't translate it because they didn't know what to do with it. They acted wisely. That's what the writer, that's what Mr. Girdlestone says. For there is no one word in the English language which is an exact counterpart of the Greek word baptizo. There's no word. You can't translate the word baptize out of Greek into English. So here's what they said. He said they did. Containing the precise ideas of the evangelist Paul. Neither less nor more. He says there's no way to do it. The difficulty, or rather the excellency of the word, is that it contains two ideas. This is one of the great Greek scholars of the last several hundred years. Contain two ideas, inclusive in the whole doctrine of baptism. Baptize is a dyer's word, D-Y-E-R-S. It's about dyeing something, dyeing clothes, not your daily dyeing. It's about coloring something. Then he says, and signifies to dip so as to color. Such as render the word dip given one true idea. But the word stood for two, and one is wanting in this rendering. Just to dip, he says, it doesn't fully deal with the word baptize. This defect is in the German New Testament, Matthew 3:1. In those days came John der Taufer, or John the Dipper, and the Dutch says, in those days came John der Duper, John the Dipper. This is the truth, but it is not the whole truth. How's that from a scholar? The Anglo-Saxon New Testament adds another idea by naming John Le Fuller. The Fuller, remember the Fuller brushman went around from house to house selling brushes? John de Fuller, the Icelandic language translate baptism, skirn, S-K-I-R-N, or washing. These convey two ideas, cleansing by washing. Let me read this. It's a really good book. Cleansing by washing, but neither do these accurately express the two ideas of the Greek word baptize. I'm going to show you what true baptism is. As the question under discussion concerns a rite, the performance of which has been held essential in all ages of Christianity, it certainly might have been supposed that this one of the cases in which an examination of the early versions would decide the matter, but the search had led to no definite result. The old Latin version, indeed, baptizo, batingo, meaning to tinge. You can't tinge with water, can you? That is, to moisten, bathe, dye, or stain. But Jerome adopted baptizo, a Latinized form of the Greek original, feeling no doubt that no Latin word could rightly convey its meaning. They wrestled themselves completely out of that translating room. And they gave up, anglicized the word, changed the vowel on the end of baptizo to an E, and called it baptized. To anglicize a word means to turn it into an English word, and it was never translated. Boy, that's one of the most important things in the world, because that's our dying daily. That's one of the corruptions of the King James Bible. I'm looking in the camera. Well, I'm a King James Bible only, and you're ignorant too. I use a King James because it comes from the correct text, the Textus Receptus. From the Latin Vulgate of Jerome, the same word spread through the influence of the church to which he belonged in the Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, French, and English languages. The Syriac version has a very good word for dipping. Syriac, that's the Syrian. For dipping, it's Latin. But never uses it for baptism, preferring a word that originally signifies to stand. And that's what a baptism would be. It would be a standing. Which was adopted possibly from the position the catechumens or the instructions took when the water was poured over him. In the Slavonic, modern Russian, and kindred languages, a term is used that is connected with crossing, making the sign of the cross, or possibly with christening. In Arabic, notice how confused the translators were. They had no idea what to do with it because they didn't know what baptism meant. And they missed the seventh chapter of Revelation, he's washed us from our sins in his own blood. If there's one baptism after Jesus dies and it's nailed to the cross, it's blood now. And that's all, isn't it? In Arabic and Persian, as also in Icelandic, we find words that signify washing or cleansing. And in Anglo-Saxon, as we have seen above, the word is almost the same. Wycliffe used wash and baptize indifferently. And he goes into his words. The German kindred languages have been cited in favor of the rendering dip. Nobody knew what to do with it. They went to every language. They couldn't figure out, what are we going to do? The English word baptized does not occur in the Old Testament, yet on examining the Septuagint, we find the Greek baptizo used twice in the canonical scriptures. Let me say something about this. If you can find two things, if you can find two words that have the same meaning, this is where you can apply algebra. Things equal to the same thing are equal to each other, aren't they? That's an algebra axiom. Things equal to the same thing are equal to each other. Each other. When you have the word atonement, on the day of atonement inside the tabernacle, the high priest would come in and he would sprinkle the blood. He would sprinkle. This is very important. This has to do with baptism. He would sprinkle the Ark of the Covenant with the blood. Now, the Methodists have got this more right than any other Protestants. And some of the Presbyterians sprinkle. The Ark of the Covenant was sprinkled. And the Day of Atonement, the word atonement is the word kafar. Kafar. The word... When the Lord told Noah, pitch the ark within and without with pitch. Pitch, verb. The second word, pitch, is a noun. Second word, pitch, is a noun. And when he says pitch, the first word, pitch, the word kafar. Second word pitch is kofar. Kafar means to cover. Kofar means to stain and dye. That has the exact same meaning as this word that they didn't know what to do with it when they were translating. Baptizo with bapto. It means to sprinkle. Now the Bible says, when it comes to sprinkling, look over here in 1 Peter. In 1 Peter 1 and 2. We're looking at things that are equal, has the same equal definition. Now look here. This would mean to cover. Verse 2, 1 Peter 1. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God, the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit. Here's what we're elected unto. Unto obedience and the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus. So we are elected, eklektos, we're favored to a blood baptism to have something sprinkled in us. Eklektos. So we're elected, just like this Ark of the Covenant was sprinkled, we're elected to be sprinkled with the blood. We'll go back over here to Hebrews. To Hebrews, the 10th chapter, we're talking about going into the Holy of Holies. This is the Holy of Holies. Mary was thrilled with herself the other night. She was watching Jeopardy, and they had a religious question, and they asked, what was the inner room of the tabernacle? And nobody on there knew that. And they had a genius on there. And Mary said, Holy of Holies. And she was tickled that she knew and they didn't know. They had one guy that was a genius on there. So this is, but you got to understand, the law was written on tables of stone. And that was the letter of the law. The law wasn't blotted out, just the letter, just the rituals, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. Remember, there's law written on tables of stone over here. Law is written on fleshy tables of our heart over here. So our hearts are the Ark of the Covenant, and whatever you do to the Ark of the Covenant has to be done to our hearts, and our hearts have to be sprinkled, doesn't it? Look here in Hebrews 10. I've gone through this real fast before. Hebrews 10. It's going to take me a good while here. Verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way. The way into heaven, by a new and living hodos. That's going to take us right straight to the narrow way, isn't it? Narrow way. So things equal to the same thing. Jesus told the apostles, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way. Oops, wait a minute. I forgot something in there. The way. The is a definite article. Articles are adjectives. There are three specific adjectives. The, a, and. That's all the articles, and they're adjectives. They tell which, what kind of, how many. The, being a definite article, it means it's only one in the scheme of this narrow way. There's only one way. It's by blood. This is very abstract thinking. It's by blood. It's when we finish this right here. And he says here, now, this is, what was I? Having therefore boldness to enter into the Holy of Holies, which is us. The Bible says that God dwelt between the cherubim. He lived upon the Ark of the Covenant, which is our hearts now. So here's true baptism right here. By a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. So he says, the veil is the flesh. Veil is the flesh of Christ. I never heard anybody in my life that thinks this abstract or thinks this analytical, this mathematical. Believe it or not, I'm teaching you first semester algebra right now. This be like taking first semester and say, we're going to teach algebra, we're going to teach it from the Bible. Is that okay? Or we're going to anyway. So this way is he's coming in, the high priest, and Jesus is the high priest over our lives, and he's coming here to do something. We're elected to the sprinkling of blood. We're elected to a blood baptism, aren't we? By a new and living way, through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. His flesh is the bread's the body, and the body's the church. And he said, my flesh is truth. Aletheia, not hiding anything. I'm actually eating flesh here by telling the truth, pulling the cover off. Having an high priest over the house of God, whose house are we, and the high priest is Melchizedek, and this is that. Christ is the son of his own house, whose house are we? We're the house of God, and inside the house of God is the veil, and that's the flesh, and that's the bread, and that's the body, and that's the church. He lives in our hearts. What does it do to our hearts? The heart was the place of understanding. And then he says here, having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled with blood, with the blood of Christ. Right? And that's dead to self. He sprinkles our hearts with his blood, and the death continues. It causes us to be willing to go on daily and tell truth to people, and they will figuratively put us to death, death meaning separation, not annihilation. Now, having our hearts sprinkled and having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and I'd need to go conscience sunnitensis, that gets back to the two witnesses. The inner man and the outer man are the two witnesses, and that's what causes us to be put to death. And our bodies washed with pure water. What did Jesus call pure water? Call the Holy Spirit pure water. In the fourth chapter of John, he says, tells the woman, I'll give you living water. They called all pure water that ran through those streams, through those mountainous streams under the ground, they called that living water. So Jesus said, I'll give you, if you don't believe in spiritual thinking and analytical thinking, you analyze something and say, what is that? You're going to miss the Bible altogether. That's what's wrong with the preachers. Well, Jesus tells them to go in all the world and teach all nations, baptizing them. Why would John say, there comes one after me, he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost, and I'm baptizing you with water. And then after his entire ministry, after he's raised from the dead, after you've nailed all the rituals to the cross, and then he tells his apostles, go into all the world and teach all nations, baptizing them in water. Why would he say that? It's the dumbest thing in the world to say, well, there's a baptism, this man is coming, Jesus, and he's going to come and tell you to continue baptizing with my water baptism, John the Baptist, and forget the one that God gave him. It sounds crazy, doesn't it? I don't even understand preachers who can't say that. They just say, you're nuts, Billy Graham. What's wrong with you, Charles Stanley? Did you flunk fourth grade arithmetic? You act like it. Makes me want to run down the road screaming, pulling my hair out. When grown men cannot see that. Now, where was I?
10:22.
Huh? 10:22. Our bodies are washed with pure water, with living water, with the truth. What does it mean our bodies are washed? Your actions, what you do, it's going to come from your mind. It's going to come out of your body. You're going to go out there and do the good works that God has ordained us to. We are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I don't understand why preachers can't see. They're blind. God's got them blind. Now, let me connect something else with this. What we're going to do, do I have any time, Mike?
6 minutes.
6? Did you say, huh?
7.
11?
7.
7. I can't get into this. I'm going to take us from Hebrews 10:20. The new and living way is the way into the Holy of Holies, isn't it? That's how our hearts are sprinkled. If there's one baptism now, that has to be it. All right, I'm going to take us back. I'm going to come back next week, come to Hebrews 10:20. We go into the holiest by a new and living way through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. We go into the Holy of Holies by a new, not the same old way, but a new and living way. When you're talking about the old high priest, that's all been blotted out. But the law is not blotted out because our high priest is Jesus. The inner sanctuary is the house of God. That's what they called it. And we're God's house. And the Ark of the Covenant was sprinkled and our hearts are sprinkled. The heart was the place of understanding. And faith is understanding, isn't it? Faith is death to self and destroying our old heart, our old understanding. He gives us a new heart of flesh, doesn't it? Now, I'm going to come back here, go to the new and living way. And it is one way to heaven, into the Holy of Holies, and then I've got to go back to John 14, where Jesus tells the apostles, I am the definite article, no other. I am the way. Well, look at that back there in John. But that's going to take me back to Christ sent me not to baptize, back in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. Now, that's funny. If you stop and think about it, it's comical. The Lord tells Paul, tells the apostles, go into all the world, teach all nations, and baptize. And they're saying, well, we read this verse here in 1 Corinthians. They're saying, well, he didn't send Paul to dip in water, just the 12. That makes no sense. Because the Lord says, everything you tell these 12, everyone who's converted by them have to go and do the same thing. So if Paul and James and John and Peter were sent to dip in water, everybody that's a believer needs to go out baptizing somebody every day. But notice what Paul says. He says, Christ sent me not to baptize. I'm just going to say it real quick. But to preach the gospel. And the gospel, according to Mark, the first chapter, the beginning of the gospel is prepare ye the way. Everywhere you find the way, you can substitute the gospel. The gospel. Everywhere you find the way. I'm going to say this again so you'll get it. And We enter in by a new and living way to have our hearts sprinkled, where the law is written on fleshy tables of our understanding. And the gospel is prepare ye the way. And John, according to the third chapter of Luke, John came preaching the baptism of repentance as it was written in the book of Isaiah, which is prepare. It's one sentence that is the gospel. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the hodos. Then we have to go into the way is narrow and filled with tribulation and trials. Y'all see what I just said? I'm going to say it again next week. John came preaching the baptism of repentance. He said the beginning of the gospel is prepare you the way. The baptism of repentance is prepare you the way. And it was written in Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Boy, we got to go over there and figure that out, don't we? I hope y'all are getting a hold of this. This is magnificent for where I'm standing. It's like, wow, this is just unbelievable the way God constructed it. So when you find out there's one baptism, it can't be anything but the way, can it? Everything else was nailed to the cross. Let me just show you. After Paul's long dead in Hebrews, well, not long dead, after Jesus' long dead. After Jesus' long dead in the book of Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews, he'll tell you about, the writer will tell you all about the other baptisms before Jesus was nailed to the cross. So if there's one baptism, it's the way. It's the hodos. It's narrow. It's full of tribulation. That's what we started off saying at the beginning. It's the tribulation out here in the wilderness that you're going through, that you're complaining about sometime. And I used to complain about a lot. And I found out it's the will of God that I go through this baptism because it's purifying my life. Makes me give up on the world and lean on Jesus is what it does. And he says over here in Hebrews 9, the writer here says, verse 8, chapter 9, the Holy Ghost this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not made known, was not made manifest, which means to reveal, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. This had to be blotted out over here. And then he says, which was just a figure. It was a parable, nothing but a shadow. It was a figure of the time then present in which were offered gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect. It could not mature a man pertaining to conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and various baptismos. See, there were a lot of them over there. They washed their vegetables ritualistically. They washed all their eating tools. They washed everything in a baptism. They was going to cleanse all the fruits and vegetables. And carnal ordinances, fleshly ordinances, the ordinances were blotted out. That don't mean anything to us anymore. And you say, I can't understand that all at once. You don't have to. It just has to be going on in you. You don't have to understand this all at once, and I don't expect you to. But you'll start getting a hold of it. I have people who will listen to me, and they'll say, I'm starting to get a hold of that. Which stood only in meats and drinks and various baptismos and carnal, fleshly ordinances. I'd like to keep on teaching. Imposed on them until the time of Reformation, deorthosis, to thoroughly messianic rectification, until Christ rectified it all on the cross, died and said, it is finished. I've nailed all that down, and it is not important anymore. All the rituals they did over here, if you get into this proselyte baptism, it's worth nothing, and that's what they're doing, dipping people in water in these churches. Everything except one baptism is gone. And that is the one that's... These are all the same up here. Blood baptism, fire, Holy Ghost and fire, they're all the same. It's the same thing that we're going through that wilderness. I'm out of time. Let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. Lord, when I teach and this comes out this way, it just is overwhelming, Lord. I don't even know what to say. Just say thank you, Lord, for letting us see this. God, will give you praise for all things. I don't know what to say anymore. Just thank you, thank you, thank you for your word. This in itself proves your word is true. Nothing could fit together like this if it wasn't true. Thank you for being our great mathematician in the heavens. Thank you for letting us see it. Fight our battles. You are fighting our battles. I'm not going to fight any more battles. The battle belongs to you. Lead us to your elect family. Lord, do with this ministry as you see fit. I don't know what else to do with it. Just do what I'm doing. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I'm going to go slow on this time through this. Those rituals is what confuse people and lead them off into. It just leads. If you get involved in a water baptism, you're never even going to think about a blood baptism. You're never going to think about if you don't know what they meant when they said something.
I don't know where he is. I'm not going to judge him. I don't know how these guys are going to get to heaven without having any of them. I don't think a man has to know all the Greek and the culture and the customs, but it has to be going on inside of him. You've got to see it in his life. Don't think you've got to all be... I got to go over a lot of this to drive it home, you know.
Right. Yeah. I'm going to get a little shovel. The little short. Careful,
wait.
He got baptized.
Lush is online.
No.
Yeah.
All right, don't worry about it.
That's why I got online.